Good evening. Thank you for tuning in to Face to Face. I'm your host, Dennis Ward. Our guest this week is the Liberal Member of Parliament for Winnipeg Centre, Robert Falcon Ouellette. It was 4 years ago this month that, Robert, you finished a strong third place in the race to become mayor of Winnipeg, receiving nearly 40,000 votes. Not long after, Ouellette ran for the Liberal Party in Winnipeg Centre and defeated longtime NDP MP Pat Martin. Robert, thank you so much for taking some time to join us here on the show. I'd like to start with something that's been taking up a lot of time in the House of Commons and debate outside as well, and that's the proposed Trans Mountain Pipeline expansion and a project that the government, your party, says will get built and is in the national interest. Just wondering what your thoughts on the project are.
Well, I think one is the government's really been trying to strike a balance, not only between the environment and jobs, but also really engaging with Indigenous peoples to make sure that there are benefits. And so, you know, I've been pushing the government on this file for almost the whole 3 years, because I think if this is going through the traditional territories of many First Nations, you know, what's the benefits to these communities? And you just don't want someone coming through, taking the resources, or leaving some risk, but not really seeing any benefit to those communities. And so far, they've signed 43 benefit agreements with some First Nations. There are still more consultations to be done, because the, you know, the appeals court, you know, ordered the government to go back and do more. There were 50,000 points of contact with Canadians and Indigenous peoples during the consultation period. I guess more needs to be done. I suspect what's going to happen in the end of the day, and I hope, is that Indigenous peoples will actually be the owners of that pipeline, so that the governments, Indigenous nations, actually have source revenue that they can use then to actually fund their own social programs, education programs, and, you know, really be independent of the federal government and not have to rely on having a good government in office. But if it was another type of government, such as a conservative government, that no matter who's in office, that they actually have their own independent source of revenue that they can then fund the projects and the programs that they believe are necessary for their people, and the people of the community then have the independence to you know, take charge of their own future. And I think part of that is having ownership of this. And I hope the federal government at the end of the day sells most of it, or at least a major portion of that pipeline, to Indigenous peoples.
So would you be meaning people along the route, communities that are along the route then?
If people listen to my speeches in Parliament, I'm actually in favor of large groups of Indigenous nations coming together. I don't really believe in the Indian Act with 634 First Nations. What I believe in is that, you know, the Cree Nation, mm-hmm. Treaty territories, but large groups of peoples working together with our collective resources. You know, it's respecting local needs and traditions, but also sharing a larger sense of what it means to be a larger nation, because together we're actually much stronger than we are apart. And, you know, there's the old, stories, you know, you take an arrow, you can crack an arrow by itself in half, but if you put many arrows together, you know, and you try and bend it and break it, you can't do it. And it's the same thing. You know, we're much stronger if we're together and working together than we are separate. And I think if those nations, you know, either Treaty 1 territory or Treaty 3, Treaty 6, Treaty 8, Treaty 9 territory were actually part of that and had ownership of it, and then shared those resources and shared the human resources, you know, together they would actually be able to build the nations that we dream about and our ancestors were dreaming about.
You'd previously expressed your own concerns with how the consultation had been done on this project. Yeah. What do you see as needing to be done to properly consult?
Well, one, I think, you know, you really do actually need to have people have some type of buy-in. You know, you need something that, you know, is clear to the people what the benefits are, you know, a public done in the communities, each individual community, not just dealing with the chiefs, but actually the elders, the young people in the community, and showing what some of the risks are, but what are some of the benefits, you know, also talking to, you know, about the needs of Canada. People are more sophisticated than the black and white that we like to portray. Not all Indigenous people are against something, not all Indigenous people are in favor of stuff. But you actually do need to, you know, engage with people, and because people actually believe people have a level of sophistication on this, on these issues, they're able to differentiate when it becomes, there's a long-term benefit. And I know there's people who are completely opposed to the oil sands, and any development of the oil and gas and petrochemicals. But that's a $400 billion industry that you have to replace in the Canadian economy if you shut it down. And right now, I just don't think we have the resources as the federal government to replace that, nor the jobs that come with it. So while we're transitioning and trying to look for new jobs, and we are spending an awful lot of money on the environment, and even I was proud to be part of the finance committee when we approved funding for the Guardians program, which is a program on the land empowering Indigenous people on leadership and to control their traditional territories, to monitor their traditional territories, to provide jobs to people to monitor their traditional territories, to really have a sense of control over their own lands. You know, I was proud to be part of the committee that helped fund that, and you know, have presentations, make you know a presentation to the finance minister, and say, please, you know, we need to be moving ahead to empower Indigenous peoples to have ownership and agency for our own lives.
There's still talk that this project could be under construction by next summer. Now it was supposed to be this summer, but
well, you know, sometimes you know, taking the, a break is a good thing. So things are done in a good way.
Do you see this project moving ahead, though?
you never know with what actually happens. What I really want is actually Indigenous peoples to have ownership of it. Northern Gateway, it was not approved at the end of the day, didn't move forward. Indigenous peoples did have some ownership in that. Energy East is not moving forward. I think we have to recognize that there are a lot of jobs which are dependent on this, that are a lot of jobs of Indigenous peoples who depend on this. But we also have to protect the environment. And these two things, sometimes they're very hard to reconcile. Like, how do you actually go about doing that? At the end of the day, you know, the thing that's going to shut down, you know, the petrochemical industry is going to be if people change their habits and the types of cars they use. And so this is why the government's brought into play pricing on pollution. So we're trying to put a price on all the pollution that we make as a country to actually help affect climate or help have a positive impact on climate change. Because we're starting to reach that, well, I think we probably have reached the tipping point in our environment. We've seen, you know, droughts and floods and, you know, tornadoes. Like, it was 34 at one point in Ottawa, right. September. And then, an hour later, it's down to 6 degrees and, you know, it causes
snowing
lots of wind, snowing.
September.
Yes, it's lovely. But it's great to have a great diversity of things like that. But when we saw the forest fires in British Columbia, what's that due to? Well, it is due to problems with the environment, and you know, we have to change people's habits. And I think that's part of the government's program, is trying to, you know, push people along that path, you know, gently at first, and stronger over time to really put a price on pollution.
Robert, I'd like to move to something that your colleague Romeo Saganash recently stood in the House of Commons and called out the Prime Minister on this issue and others. Here's some of what he had to say.
When the Prime Minister insists that this pipeline expansion will be done no matter what, and his minister adds that Canada will not be able to accommodate all Indigenous concerns, what that means is that they have decided to willfully violate their constitutional duties and obligations. Mr. Minister, Mr. Speaker, sounds like a most important relationship, doesn't it? Why doesn't the Prime Minister just say the truth and tell Indigenous peoples that he doesn't give a about their rights?
Robert, what do you have
to... Well, I think the Prime Minister does give an F about the rights of Indigenous peoples. We have spent $17 billion in the last two budgets for Indigenous peoples. We have increased funding enormously. We're about to come out with we've been working on Child and Family Services Act. We've been working on an Indigenous Languages Act. We're working on rights tables, looking at land and how it's, the sovereignty of Indigenous nations and what that means. We've recognized the UN Declaration of the Rights of Indigenous Peoples. We've just passed a bill in Parliament recognizing the rights of Indigenous peoples and the UN Declaration of UNDRIP. I think our Prime Minister's gone above and beyond of what could be expected. I'm pretty proud of the accomplishments that we've had. We're building water treatment plants all across the country right now. 77 have long-term water boil advisories have been lifted. We have school board right here in Manitoba, 12 First Nations working together trying to build a better education system for their kids. We're funding more and more schools. We're building more schools. We're building a hospital in northern Manitoba, a $100 million hospital for Indigenous peoples in Cross Lake. The list goes on, and I have trouble keeping up. I'm the chair of the Indigenous Caucus in Ottawa, and I have so much trouble keeping up with Indigenous services and what they're trying to do. People really do care. All my colleagues care. All the non-Indigenous colleagues care. We're not a lot of Indigenous MPs, but I know my colleagues are great allies. We just had a Indigenous Champions Caucus meeting on Monday, and there were 40 non-Indigenous MPs, Liberals, who had come out to this meeting to hear how they could help advance the issues that not only the Minister of Indigenous Services is facing, but also Crown Relations, how they can lobby other ministers, departments, their own citizens, the mayors, their provincial leaders, their provincial politicians, in order to push this, an idea of reconciliation and the nation-to-nation relationship. Nothing is ever perfect. I wish it was perfect, but you're never going to get, perfection. If people believe in perfection, just look in the mirror. I'm not perfect. I make tons of mistakes. I'm sure, you do as well. Right. But we're going to get, we're going to try and get it right.
Can you appreciate, though, how some people might in their communities feel that way? That the government doesn't care?
Well, I think the government hasn't cared for 150 years. In fact, not only have they not cared, they've actually been actively trying to destroy Indigenous peoples and their cultures for 150 years. Mm-hmm. And in this case, now we've changed direction 180, and we have a prime minister who's trying to do something completely different. I understand people are very, there's a lot of anger because it's been built up over so many generations of disrespect, of a cultural genocide which has occurred for a long time. But my fear is, and this is the truth, is if governments are going to look at this moment, and this is kind of the deciding time, in 3 years, if we can't get this right now and we fail at our tasks, and I'm talking about the Liberal government with the Prime Minister we have today, right, will any other government take up this mantle? Will any other government coming afterwards say this is a worthwhile project? Or will they say, look, even though they work so hard and they put so much of their budget and their political capital on the line, greater deficits in our budgets, right, that we're criticized daily for by the Conservatives, would anyone else take that up? Would they take that task up? And my fear is like a referendum in Quebec. People will put it to the side and hope it goes away. And, it'll be in another 40, 50 years that maybe someone will try and deal with it. Right. But we're really trying to change the Indian Act. We're really trying to move these things, indigenous rights. And it is a difficult problem because, you have a bureaucracy sometimes that has difficulty responding. They've been conditioned to respond in a certain way by the Conservatives, to be risk adverse. We're asking them to take the initiative, to actually go out and do things, to engage with people. That takes time to get new people and new ideas and new ways of thinking into place.
Sorry, Robert, I'm going to have to hold you there because we've got to take some time as well pay the bills and throw it a break here. But we'll be right back to continue our conversation with a Member of Parliament for Winnipeg Centre, Robert Falcon Ouellette, here on Face to Face.
Minakwewin, Omomistae, Imachi, Matawak. Aqua, imaskao, simakak, uspin otak, kutakote mukuk, mistue, apukita, miikawak.
Welcome back to Face. That was our guest this week, Robert Falcon Ouellette, the MP for Winnipeg Centre. And just a small part, Robert, of your 3.5-minute speech or so in the House of Commons where you spoke Cree. Well, what was that moment like for you?
It was pretty cool, but I'm looking for translation and interpretation of what I say. I once gave a speech in the House and no one did any interpretation. So usually if you speak French, there'll mm-hmm. be someone interpreting or translating into English and vice versa. And I wanted to give a speech in Cree, and I gave one, and they refused to provide the services because no one had ever asked for it before. And then I pushed him, and we discovered the rules wouldn't allow it. So it's been about a 2-year process now, almost. Mm-hmm. And we're getting close to a final conclusion. We have a report now. A committee studied it, where I was able to testify. And, you know, the end result has been that the House of Commons has agreed to offer interpretation services in Indigenous languages. I was just speaking with the head of the interpretive and translation services for the House of Commons. They're ready for about 20 languages very soon. They have interpreters lined up to start this as soon as MPs like myself request the service. Right. And for me, this is part of a larger dream that comes to something out of Winnipeg Centre, which is actually the University of Winnipeg. The president, Annette Trimby, said they have developed computer programs that need mass or metadata to plug in, so language, and they need not just a couple, you know, children's books to put in and, you know, a few dictionaries, but they actually need a living language. And the House of Commons, because they do so much language, it's, you know, all the time, it would be good to fit into that. And so that way you could do the Google Translate and other types of things, not only into Chinese and into Spanish, but you could do into the Cree language for the very first time. And so this is what I've been working on quite diligently. I've got the Indigenous Languages Act. I've got funding now for the Indigenous Languages Act. I've been working quite assiduously and hard to get more funding and to improve this, because these languages are dying. They're almost done, actually. Right. And, you know, you can tell I'm not a great speaker. It's pretty rough out there for me. Like, I'm, but, you know, I try my best, you know. But, you know, these things, you know, take time. And I really want people to be able to, you know, a grandmother on reserve to be able to turn on the television and to be able to say, oh, we can watch the great debates of Parliament in Cree. And the kids can have it on in the background, and we can be part of this country. And our languages are important enough that we actually translate them, and they are alive, and we can use them in any situation.
You make mention of some of the things you're working on right now, but you know, at times you have been at odds with your own party.
Has of course, that that's my role.
Yeah, do you think that has had an impact on your role, and perhaps some of the roles you could be offered as a member of Parliament?
One thing, if you're, in cabinet or as a parliamentary secretary, you have to speak for the government. You are a government member. Right now, the role I think I have to play is I really need to speak for the people of Winnipeg Centre. And so, for instance, a couple weeks ago, I was sleeping out in Central Park here because of the violence and some of the meth crisis that's going on, the solvent abuse, really trying to get a good grips on what's going on and, you know, trying to make sure that the whole neighbourhood, the whole center of the city, the heart of Canada, really is a safe place for everyone to be, that it doesn't exist, or it shouldn't exist, a no-go zone, any part in Canada where you're told you shouldn't go out at night by the police. Right. It's unsafe. Apparently the RCMP did call the PMO's office to say, you have an MP that's sleeping out in Central Park.
Oh, really?
Are you concerned about that?
Yeah.
And, you know, the PMO's office, the Prime Minister's office said, yeah, Robert's, you know, he's fighting for his citizens. He's trying to make a difference. And so, I'm actually quite proud of that, because I actually learned a lot. One, it's very cold and it's hard for our homeless citizens. And there's 1,500 in the city of Winnipeg. And we have 2,000 homeless in Vancouver, 1,500 in Winnipeg. And that's a tough life. And we don't do enough. We don't have enough housing. We don't have enough addiction treatment facilities. We don't have safe zones where you can get medical treatment for your addictions, where you can get the things that you need to, you know, help yourself get on the right path. And we don't do that because these people usually don't, our fellow citizens don't vote. They don't donate. They are not rich. They're not going to go to the receptions. They're not hanging out at the pool with their kids on a Sunday where they can talk to the member or the MLA or the city councillor. They're, you know, at Siloam, Main Street, and Salvation Army. And they are just as important to our city as anyone else. And they're just as important, because if we're afraid to go downtown to these areas, if we're afraid to walk around at night, that impoverishes us all. That impoverishes our city. And so I've been bringing this message back to Ottawa. What are we doing, and when are we doing it? So I'm happy about the housing $40 billion for housing that they're coming. I'm pushing the government now. When are we actually going to start building? When's the money going to start flowing for the homelessness issue in our cities? What are we doing about drug addiction? So I'm pleased the the health minister is actually trying to deal with the opioid crisis, and she's trying to start now to deal with the meth crisis. But you know, like, keep pushing. Ralph Goodell came out with $327 million on a gang reduction violence project, or projects. Let's start. We need to start getting that money out the door into the hands of people who could actually make a difference to make not only the rest of Canada safe, but especially, Winnipeg.
Right. My crew is pushing me to take one more break, so we'll be right back to continue our conversation with Robert Falcon Ouellette here on Face to Face. Welcome back to Face to Face. Our guest is Member of Parliament Robert Falcon Ouellette. And Robert, before the break, we kind of discussed how you've been at odds with your own party in Ottawa at times. There was also a point where you were at odds with some in the Indigenous community, and that was over some of your comments following the acquittal of Gerald Stanley and some of the comments that you made there. Why did you make those comments, I guess?
Well, I'm not a person to shy away. I'm not a wilting flower, that's for sure. But I also try and speak what I think is the truth. And, people might not like it, but at the end of the day, I'm here as well as trying to build bridges between communities. And, what Gerald Stanley did is wrong. You shouldn't kill anyone. But there are some underlying issues that are not being dealt with. And it's wrong to take the life of a young man, any young man. But I offered my regrets that he had taken a life, that he has to bear that for himself for the rest of his life, knowledge that he took a life of someone, that his life will be forever changed. But also, it offers the opportunity to kind of build those bridges, because Indigenous people, we're not going to be able to do this by ourselves. We're going to have to find ways of building bridges in places like Saskatchewan, where there is a lot of racism, in North Battleford and, Yorkville. How are we going to do that if we're at opposite ends all the times? Who is going to be able to extend their hand and say, what can we do to work together? How many times have mayors in Saskatchewan actually sat down and have a conjoint council meeting of their city council with the local band council? Probably doesn't happen very often.
Right.
But it would be a good idea if we did it. Because if we don't start doing those things, we're going to be repeating the mistakes over and over and over again. And, farmers, they might have, they do have concerns. But, I'm concerned about getting people jobs as well. So how do you, if there are farmers that need employees and they're going to the Philippines to get them, are there Indigenous peoples that could be on the farms working, learning excellent skills, setting up their own businesses, their own pork factories and chicken farms and raising cattle and growing grain and doing all these things and creating jobs for themselves so that they can empower their children, have resources, financial resources to make their lives better. And this requires that we extend a hand. In some way.
Robert, it's extending a hand is a good way to end the show. Unfortunately, we do have to end the show because we are out of time.
But thank
you for being on. And that is all the time we have for today. You can find us online at aptn.ca.